Well, welcome. Thank you for joining us. So as I said, if we're having a little trouble reading the screen, we'll dim the lights and make it a little bit easier. As Sue said, I'm actually a certified financial planner, CFP. I do fee-only planning now. For any of you who knew me at Jones, I don't do any sales anymore. But this is one of my interests, and partly because I have three kids of my own. And if any of you know my kids, don't ask them if they follow any of the advice I'm going to give you in the next 2 hours. but I'll talk a little bit about them as we go along, because they're three different kids. So obviously this is something that's concerning to lots of parents. And I guess the kind of the first thing I'd like to do is talk a little bit about you. I'm probably going to be preaching to the choir a little bit, because you're actually here willing to sit through 2 hours of figuring out how to do this. But if there are particular concerns, I certainly want to hear about them. Interrupt me at any time and ask questions. Because we're a smaller group, it'll be great if you actually are doing something that's working to share that with the rest of the group, if you don't mind, because I'm always learning too. Okay, so let's see if I can actually make this change. Okay, our kids are smarter than we think, right? We assume they're not listening, they're spending money, but they actually have a pretty good sense of how powerful it is to ask mom and dad for money, right? Okay, so I wanted to share just some statistics. So if you're not concerned enough by just being here, this hopefully will spur you and motivate you to do even more. The average student loan debt on graduation from college, $25,000. That may be your debt, it may be your kids, it may be a combination, but you know, that's what a lot of kids come out of college having to grapple with. Percent of undergrads with credit cards, 76%. I think what I found in talking with my own clients as well as doing these presentations is that by and large kids get to college without a lot of knowledge about how to deal with these things. And as parents, we just kind of hand them all of this and say, okay, you're on your own now. So one of my goals today is to get you to start thinking about, even if I have a child in middle school, now is the time to start talking to them about this. You don't have to give them a credit card tomorrow. That won't be one of my suggestions, but to start talking about it. Average credit card debt per household, almost $15,000. So clearly, as a generation, I think we did not necessarily grow up learning how to handle credit wisely, something that we probably want to try and help our kids handle a little bit better. This was an amazing statistic to me. 18 to 25-year-olds who are working out in the workforce are not contributing to their 401k. Part of it's because, you know, they've got a lot of other expenses, not a lot of salary, but the reality is they're not in the discipline of saving. That hasn't been instilled in them. The percent of all girls who will have to take care of themselves at some point in their life, 90%. And there are, I won't talk a lot about it today, but there are gender differences in how we talk about money with boys and girls. And there are pros and cons to each. But this is critical, and I see this when I meet with my widows and retired clients who, for the first time at 70-something, are having to figure out how to deal with money. So if you have daughters, who here has a daughter? Okay, so all but one. This is something that's critical to make sure you're having these conversations with girls. The average age when adult children move out, 27. Okay, if anything, this is why you are here today. Okay, so that number is not, you are not the average.
You've got to lower that.
Right, exactly. Come on in. There are a couple seats over here too. Just be careful of the wires. Okay. So, have I scared everybody sufficiently to pay attention for the next 2 hours? Okay, good. All right.
Okay, wait a minute.
All right. So, why don't parents talk about money with kids? I mean, we have to talk to kids. We have to talk to kids about sex. We have to talk to kids about drugs. But for some reason, those two things are easier to talk about with kids than to talk with them at any length about money and how to handle money. Who believes that? Anybody here think that it's harder to talk to kids about money? No? Okay, that's the impression that I often get. it is. I'm not saying they're easy, right? So, but let's talk about for a minute whether it's easy for you or not. I'd like to know, just so I make sure I'm addressing concerns that you specifically have, why you think it might be difficult for parents, or things that are hard for parents to talk about money and money matters and financial matters with their kids. Money in many households is really still a taboo topic, and this is what I was talking about a little bit earlier. How much do you share? How much do you really, I mean, we're taught when we go to a cocktail party not to tell everybody what we make, right? Or not to talk about politics and religion and money. Mm-hmm. And so we, you know, maybe unconsciously really share that with our kids, that this is not something we need to talk a lot about. We're actually not comfortable with our own knowledge, right? We recognize that there are things that we should be teaching our kids, but we don't really know them ourselves, so we avoid the topic. Does anybody here have plenty of time to talk about this? This is probably a big, you know, obviously a big issue around a lot of things in raising kids today, but especially when two parents work, but even when they don't, I mean, our kids are overscheduled, we're overscheduled, when are you going to talk about it? Because it's not just one conversation. It's an ongoing conversation. Kids aren't interested. Like, hey, you're giving me money, why do I care, right? So you've got to figure out ways to make your kids interested in this topic. We want kids to feel secure and not worry, especially if there's been some uncertainty in the, you know, job situation. That's the last thing we want kids to be worrying about. So how do we keep that security? Sometimes we just don't know how to get started on some of this. So hopefully today we'll at least help address that. Okay, here are my goals for you. To feel better about something you're already doing, because you probably are doing more than you realize. I'm going to throw out several ideas today. Some are going to seem kind of off the wall, some you may already be doing, but just make a commitment to take away two new ideas to try. If you do try more, that's great. I think this is really important. Get out of your comfort zone, your reluctance to push your kids to financial responsibility at this age. And in some of these ideas, don't say, I'm never going to do that. What is she talking about? Say, you know, I'll try it. May not work, but I'll try it. And really important, understand it takes practice and repetition. It's not going to work. A lot of times, it's not going to work the first time or the second time or even the third time. So if you believe in the idea, you think it's important, try it again and again and again, because it sometimes takes a while to kick in with certain kids. The next thing I want to do is talk about your kids' money personalities, because those are still evolving a little bit, but I'll bet you can identify the type of kid you have. Here are the kids' money personalities, and we're not going to, and I'll hand this out, we're not going to talk about all of these, but I can tell you I have three kids, and I've got a spendthrift, I've got a hoarder, and I've got an oblivious. And so I have to manage those kids a little bit differently and motivate them a little bit differently when it comes to money. So a spendthrift, just for instance, a spendthrift is, you know, I think we all kind of know what that is. Kids love when they can give money and get stuff. Wow, that is a great feeling. It's a great feeling of power for some kids to be able to do that. But it can also mean that there's a little bit of loss of control here too, that kids can be a little bit out of control when they're a spendthrift. They're just like, there's so much they want, and they, you know, mm-hmm. so they never save because they're spending it as soon as it comes in. Now, depending on their age, and of course we're going to talk about some of this stuff in generalities, but depending on their age, you know, there are a couple things that you can do. And I'd be curious if anybody is already doing this with a kid, if they feel like that's the personality they have. One is to really, before you ever go shopping with a child, is to sit down and really say, okay, what are we budgeting? What are we going to, you know, what is it specifically you want? Make them spend a little bit of time figuring out the cost ahead of time. And spendthrifts, you know, are more than happy to do that, especially with online access to everything. They can go figure out pretty much how much they can buy for that money. But what it does is it takes away that kind of loss of control when they're out there seeing all these other things in the shop. They know exactly what they're going to get. They know how much it's going to cost. They know they're not going to go over their budget. And so it kind of gives them back a little bit of control. It's also instilling a great habit anytime around shopping. But a lot of kids, especially parents today, they'll say, oh, you've got a, you know, $25 gift card, let's go. And that creates a lot of, even though they may be very excited, can create a lot of, you know, craziness when you're in the store, right? Has anybody done that, been there, done that? Okay. Mm-hmm. So try that the next time if you've got a child that really can't hold on to money, because what they may find is that they actually can get what they want and then even have a little bit left over. And so it's a conversation that happens outside of a shopping environment. The hoarder, I bring this up because we tend to encourage and reward hoarders at this age. They're good savers, right? That's a good trait. But what can happen is that, and this happens, tends to be a little bit more with the younger kids that do this. They still like counting the money, and they like counting it up and keeping it, and they don't really want to give it away because then it's gone. That's okay. Come on through. This is one that you don't necessarily want to discourage the saving behavior, but if you find that your child is not ever spending that money, you may want to start to have some conversations with them about what they're saving for, why they're saving, so that they understand that it's about managing the money. It's not about just counting it and keeping it. It may signal a lack of confidence about making choices, so you want to address that. And then, we've got the scrimper. This is the one who comes, this is your budget shopper, right? Who comes home and always has money left over. And again, behavior that's not a bad behavior, but if it gets to the point where this is becoming an issue around them making good choices, you want to have that conversation. We've got the giver. At one point I had one of my children, when they were fairly young, would take their money allowance to school and give it away every day. They come home like, I gave so-and-so. Like, why'd you do that? So, you've got that kind of behavior that gets corrected pretty quickly. But then you also, even in adults, you can see all of these traits, right, in adults. I'll give you another example. I had a client who was on a retired income, and they couldn't figure out where their money was going. I mean, we knew what all the fixed expenses were, and we couldn't figure out why she was without money each month. Well, it turns out she was giving away a significant portion of her fixed income to charitable contributions in $10, $15, $25 increments. If something came in the mail, she was writing a very small. So it never occurred to her that, she was outspending and giving away more than she should have because she wasn't tracking it. And she was, so you've got people that are very generous. You again want to encourage that, but understand, help them understand if they're doing it. But the beggar, I mean, we've all had a kid like that, right? Can I? Obviously, there's a real quick fix to here. The answer is no, you can't. But it's hard when you're out, you're busy, you're like, oh, okay, fine, just stop bugging me. The hustler, the one who says, oh, but mom said, or oh, but dad said, or, is trying. They're great at negotiation, which is a good skill to have, but you want to be mindful of this. And then the oblivious, as I said, and this, this it, unfortunately a lot of times pertains to girls, especially middle school girls, who, just doesn't want to be bothered. You're going to pay for something great. I don't need to know all these details, right? So if you have a child, boy or girl, that just does not seem to want to pay attention to this, you don't want to continue to allow that behavior, basically. You want to make sure they're taking some responsibility. It's easy for me to stand up here and tell you, figure out which one your kid is and fix it. It takes a while, but it's being mindful of that personality and recognizing that there are extremes in each of these. Okay. All right, so as we say, we're gonna kind of focus on middle school. Who here has a middle school child? Almost everybody. Who's got high school? Anybody with high school? Okay. And younger, elementary. Okay, good. So I'll try and college. Okay. All right. Good. So some of this will be more relevant than others, but I think it will. It's really about where your child is on the spectrum. So more than their age. But I bring up the middle school things because I think when you're trying to come up with ways to talk to your child, these are three things you want to always be mindful of that will engage them. This is the time when they start trying to figure out what they're passionate about. Some of them know. Some of them very clearly know. I have one child that's very passionate about how many clothes she can stuff into her closet. So, for her, if it's a conversation around money, it probably needs to revolve around her clothing budget. Independence. I mean, this is, again, a time when they're trying to exert independence. You're trying to hold on but give them independence at the same time. And these are things that can really play out in the way you handle money with them. It's also important that they start to realize there are real consequences to bad decisions. You know, when they buy something and it breaks, you're not going to go back to the store and replace it, you know, which you may or may not have done when they were younger. So it's really important just to keep these three things in mind as you design ways to talk with your kids. Okay. So what I'm going to spend most of the time today talking about are the 10 basic money skills you want your children to know by the time they go off to college. You want them to be able to talk about money comfortably. You want them to be able to save. You want them to be able to keep track of money. So it's not enough to just say. They actually have to learn how to keep track of it. Get paid what you're worth. So they need to start making the connection between things don't come for free. You get paid something, and things are relative about how much people are willing to pay for it. And that's how you get money. And this, I think, this is a very, it sounds so simple, but I think at this age, this is a hard thing for us as parents to start to really enforce, because we're so used to just paying for things for them. We want them to spend wisely, not to be afraid to spend. I do see people as adults who don't spend enough or appropriately. It causes issues in a marriage. It can cause, you know, issues around, those are bad choices in and of themselves when they're not spending or afraid to spend. So it's about spending wisely. How to live within a budget. Anybody here actually do a budget? Yeah, good. Because a lot of people don't. A lot of adults don't. But it's very important to understand how to do that, however you define budgeting and however detailed it may be. I think you really want to teach your kids to be comfortable with investing. As adults, many adults are not comfortable with this. But in this day and age, as someone mentioned it earlier, now is a perfect example. Rates are so low that if you are not doing this, you are not going to have enough money later on. Doesn't mean you have to go crazy. Doesn't mean you have to try and time the stock market. But understanding the basic concepts of investing. Be an entrepreneur. Now, not everybody and not every child is going to be an entrepreneur. But starting to teach your child about creative ways to make money, and to be creative within, even within the most basic job that they may get as a teenager or when they first come out, will allow them again to start making those connections. Hey, if I'm creative about this, I either am going to get a promotion, or I'm going to make more money, or however you define it. Handling credit. It's unrealistic today to expect kids to never have a credit card or never pay for anything on credit. I mean, look at, you know, most people in the room probably have a mortgage, which is the biggest debt we have. So, you know, having them understand how to handle this will be very important. And then giving responsibly. And again, this comes back to defining your own money values. But, you know, many parents want to be able to teach their kids how to put giving in the context of their overall financial situation. Okay? So we'll go through these. Okay, so how to talk about money comfortably. And this is where I'm going to get into some specific examples that you can try at home. So we have this, what I call family money vision. Now, I just had you do a little, you know, small exercise. There are certainly a lot of resources out there that are much more involved in terms of figuring out your real money behavior and identifying and fine-tuning what you value around how you spend money. You know, how you're going to give money. But it's important to actually spend a little time articulating this, both between the adults as well as with your kids, sharing with them, this is what we think about, you know, money. And that can include, for instance, the question I get all the time is allowance. So how many people here pay their kids allowance? Okay. And this is really always kind of usually a 50-50 split. How many tie them to chores in the house? How many tie allowance to chores? Nobody. Okay, so that's interesting, because a lot of people will do that. There's no right or wrong answer here, but I often get that question.
When you say tie it to chores, do you mean like if you clean this bathroom, you get this much money, or do you mean you're expected to do, you know, this on the weekend if you expect to get your allowance?
Right, both. So some parents will have extra chores that they will pay extra money for.
Right.
That's almost like having a job, right? Yeah. So that's one idea. Some parents will say, these are the chores you have to do in order to get your allowance. And some parents will say, I'm going to separate the two completely. Chores are something we do because we're a family. Allowance is different. So, again, no right or wrong answer here. Just be clear on what you're doing and be consistent. You know, and I can tell you, my own family, we have tried it both ways to figure out what works. The rooms are still messy.
What works?
The rooms are still messy. Either way, so I will tell you, most financial advisors will say do not tie regular chores to allowance. I think that's an individual family's decision around how you do it. I personally like the idea of having extra chores that are fall outside the weekly chores. If your child is really wanting to buy something and needs some extra money, I think that's a great way to do it. The other thing that you want to ask yourself, if you haven't already, and think about the way you've handled past situations, is allowance a reward or is it a deterrent or neither? For instance, some people will give allowance or extra money, not just allowance, but extra money for good grades. If you get all A's, I'll give you an extra. If you win, and this has happened in my household, if you win X number of swimming races, I'll give you a buck, you know. I don't necessarily advocate that. I think, you know, maybe sending a little bit of mixed messages, but again, you want to be consistent. Are we going to reward good behavior with money or not? And the flip side is, are we going to take away money for bad behavior? If you don't clean your room, I'm docking your allowance. And I don't know about you, but I think every parent, in the moment of exasperation, has used that exact line. If you don't do it, you don't get your allowance. That's fine. But is that the behavior you really want to be modeling on a consistent basis? And it may be fine. How are you going to use money when you celebrate? You know, this is another, again, around the money vision. Are you going to save up and make a big deal about saving up for special celebrations? Are you going to give monetary rewards to celebrate? It's something that you really just want to understand. Are we being consistent about this? Is this something we're comfortable with when we think about it? One that came up earlier. How much detailed financial information are you really willing to share with your kids at this age? Now, again, most financial advisors will tell you kids understand a lot more than you think and appreciate the openness and honesty a lot more than you may think. You obviously have to have, in the context of any conversation around sensitive financial matters, explaining what stays within the household, what doesn't get. But middle school is a great place to start these conversations because kids are old enough to understand they can't go off and talk about it on the playground. I think this is personally, we're not good at it either. I think this is an area that we need to start a little bit younger than we typically do as parents in talking with kids about the overall financial situation. Now, that doesn't mean you need to sit down and go through the tax returns with your kids. But to start to talk about, you know, mom's job, dad's job, relative incomes, incomes that you have for certain types of jobs, how much things cost, I think it is important to share with your kids. You may feel like it's going in one ear and out the other, but I think it's important that they start hearing that there's cost associated, and there's also rewards associated with, you know, when dad has to work till 10 o'clock at night, we get to do X. I think also talking about your attitude about debt, you know, what is your attitude about debt? And I say that because, of course, everybody says debt's bad. But the reality is you probably have a mortgage. Maybe you don't, but most people have a mortgage. It's a big, big chunk of money. And just as you said, talking to them about what does that mean? You know, how does that work? And good and bad debt, you know, versus credit card debt. Because that will be hard for, and that may be hard for kids to really understand. You've got a mortgage that's, you know, X amount, and you've got a credit card debt that's this tiny little amount in comparison, and yet that's really bad. So how do you have that conversation with them? And then your attitude about investing. and you saw the questions here, you know, some people are big, you know, firm believers. They're going to put their money in the bank, investing, you know, investing, meaning investing in the stock market is too risky. Whatever your beliefs are, you need to be comfortable with them and comfortable with imparting them to your kids or talking about it with your kids so that they start to understand. So spend some time doing this. And again, this won't be a one conversation. It will probably be several conversations, but understanding that. The next thing I'm going to suggest is not something I have done, but if you're feeling a little bit overwhelmed with all these areas and being confident about talking about all these areas, is putting together what's called a money mentoring team. Many of you probably have relatives in the area or close friends who do different things. Maybe you've got, you know, you've got a close friend or a brother or sister who, you know, has done well in the stock market or is really great about finding bargains or whatever it is, and you're not. You know, don't be shy about really, you know, bringing in people that you trust to help with the aspects you're not comfortable with talking about with your kids. They'll be, I'm sure, honored to do it, but it'll also provide your child with another perspective if you feel you're lacking. Paying bills. So here's an exercise you can try if you haven't done it already. While we may not want to share all of our financial information with our children, you know, right off the top, a good way to get started on this is the utility bill, because kids can relate to that a little bit better, and you're probably tired of telling them to turn off the lights all the time, right? Mm-hmm. So take your, and I actually say take 3 months or even 6 months of utility bills, because they do vary, and sit down with your kids. But before you show them the bill, say, how much do you think it costs, you know, to each month for all of our electricity or gas or oil or whatever? And let them throw out a few numbers, and I'm sure they'll be very different than what they really are. And then sit down and go through it with them and show them the bill. Show them what a bill looks like. I mean, a lot of kids never see a bill until they're confronted with them in adulthood. Show them what the bill looks like and go through it and say, okay, here, you know, here's what we're paying. And then you may even want to say, and this is X percent of all of our expenses, if that's a meaningful number. But then you want to take this exercise a step further and say, okay, if this were your bill, what do you think we could do to lower it? And let them come up with some suggestions, you know, and that's why I like using the electric bill, because they can say, well, we could turn off the lights, or we could turn down the heat, or we could, you know, get the, whatever those, as you can see, we don't have them in our house, the little curlicue bulbs that, you know, last a lot longer. So they're, you know, and kids are pretty imaginative about this, but all of a sudden now it's their problem too. So, has anybody tried that exercise already? Okay, so that's one thing you could do. Affordability and choice, and I think someone mentioned this earlier, and I had a comment from someone who couldn't come to this, who said this was her biggest issue. It's hard, especially when your kids got a little bit older, to say we can't afford it. It's like, what are you talking about, Mom? Of course we can afford it. But it's really not, and that's not what you're really trying to say. Usually, sometimes you really can't afford it. But what you're really trying to say is, I choose not to pay for this. This is not where I want to spend my money. So it's just a subtle difference in how you answer that question, but it provides a great teaching moment for a child. When what you really want to say is, we can't afford that, you want to back up a minute and say, well, okay, we could afford that, but here's what we would give up instead. Or we can't go do this. And this is, again, where we get into talking to them about their passions and their interests. Yeah, we could go do that, but then you're not going to get to do X, Y, and Z. And have them start to understand it's about choices. It'll make the conversation more interesting and easier, really, for you. And again, you know, I can't stress this enough, because I just feel like we, as parents in our generation, don't do this enough. Start talking to them, helping them make the link between job, career, passion. It's not that everybody is going to follow their bliss in their first job out of school. But understanding the links and the relationships so that they can start to understand that this is what's going to fuel and fund their lifestyle as they get older. saw an example in one of these books, and I can't remember which one it was now, but it was a good example of a 12-year-old who really, really wanted to be an actress. And I thought this was a great exercise. And so her mom finally said, that's great, you know, but let's actually think about that for a minute. I'm happy for you to be an actress, but I really want you to understand what that means. So with the beauty of the internet, this child went on and said, okay, let's say I graduate from school. What am I going to have to do to become a famous actress? And so let's figure out the associated cost. Well, I mean, you know, there's probably only a few places I can live. What's the rent like? You know, what's it going to cost me to live there? Probably have to take some acting classes. What does that cost? And she went and looked up real costs for all of these things. What's the likelihood that I'm actually going to get paid anything the first couple of years? And therefore, I'm going to have to take a different job. What's that job going to look like? You know, so having that conversation, having a child go through that, made her realize, wait, well, okay, this now I know what I'm up against. Maybe I still want to be an actress, but I know really what that's going to look like. Now, another way to do this, or something you could add on in front of that exercise, if your child really wants to do X, is to say, okay, that's great. Let's figure out how much you want to, when you get out of college, what do you think your life's going to look like? Have them list, you know, well, I want to be able to do this. I want to drive this kind of car. You know, let them say, realistically, when you get out of school, what do you think, you know, what kind of apartment do you want to live in? What do you want to have around you? What kind of vacation do you want to take? Get them to start, you know, listing all of those, figuring out those costs, and then go to have them go do this. And that is a real eye-opening experience for a middle schooler or a high schooler to start to see. And I don't mean to say do this so that you're going to discourage them from doing something they really want to do. That's really not the point of the exercise. The point of the exercise is for them to see, I want this lifestyle, so I've got to make X money in order to do it. Does that make sense? Yeah. So let's see. I'll go through that other example next time. So that's not to say you have to tell them everything, right?
Yeah.
A little bit of knowledge goes a long way. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So how to save. Now, this is the piece that we all probably is easiest for us. We get right with our kids, I think, probably more than anything else. One thing that I have found incredibly successful is what I call the four-part piggy bank. I give my kids an allowance, and I make them divide it into four parts. Spend now, save for later, invest, and donate. And I have them do it equally. You can say, you can do different percentages, whatever works for you. But that has been a great way to have conversations about each of those pieces. Now, I will tell you, with rare exception, in their mind, they treat the spend now and save later as one bucket. You know, that's the spend now bucket. They have a hard time thinking about saving beyond a week or two. But it has been great for getting them in the discipline of putting something away for later, and also about giving something away, because then we have periodic conversations about where are we going to give this money. I would say, it's very easy to do this. I started off with literally a four-part piggy bank that I got from Money Savvy Generation. I forget the exact name. It's on a list I'll give you later. That worked for a while, and then as my kids got older, we started using an online active allowance, because what I found, I don't know, tell me if anybody has this experience, with three kids, I give an allowance of $1 for their age. So I was always having to carry around weird amounts of bills and coins and trying to do math in my head, and
so
I never had the right...
Per week,
yeah. Yeah. Now that's a fairly common, again, no right or wrong answer here, but that is somewhat common advice, the dollar for their age. That, you know, when they're little, that's more than they need. Mm-hmm. When they're in high school, it's probably not enough. So you may want to tweak that on both ends. I think in middle school, it actually seems to work pretty well for them. So I moved away from the all cash method of allowance giving,
because I was always behind and couldn't remember, and it was really me. Okay, it wasn't my kids, it was me. I couldn't do it. So I moved to this online called Active Allowance. At some point, you need to get them comfortable with actually having a real account, right? How many here have kids who have saving account? Good, great. See, I told you you can walk out of here feeling good about what you're doing, right? So if you don't, though, it is a great thing to do. You want to make sure that you're periodically moving that saving money, whatever piece of that, over to a real account at a real bank where they have to really go down there and withdraw it, and they have to keep track of it, right? So that I think is very, very important.
Do you think it's crucial that it be a local bank where they can go physically and withdraw it?
Personally, I think it is good at this age. To that physicality is somewhat important, just like for younger kids.
What if they have an ATM card that they can use? Does that make a difference?
I don't think it makes a difference. If they are comfortable in learning, I mean, they're going to have to learn how to use ATM cards, right? So if they're comfortable with that and they understand how it works and that there's only X amount in there.
Yeah, because we don't have a local bank, so they have the same thing as we do.
Right.
But it's all online, which I think does make it a little bit more...
It does. That's my concern, and it's my concern with my own kids, that we are a culture, a nation of ordering online, doing everything online, and that real... that I mean, there's still something to be said about really having to touch and feel cash, and we're going to get to a point where that's not even an option, I think. But at this age, I think it is important for kids to understand that. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
They like to look up how much they have.
They need to be able to see. And so, you know, they need to be able to see what their balance is, and they need to be able to keep track. And this gets into my next one about counting coins and bills. I mean, this is something that our kids learn in kindergarten, but then they sort of never really have to do it anymore. And I noticed this the other day. I was out somewhere, and there was a high school kid who had to give me change. And couldn't, you know, had no idea how to count out change. And you think about that. I mean, if anybody here ever worked in retail, yeah, that's like one of the first things you learn is how to count. Right. You don't, because the machine tells you. Right. So I understand all that. I recognize all of that. I'm trying very hard to deal with it myself. But spend a few minutes teaching your kids how to count change. They may never have to. They may never be in a job where they have to. But at some point, they're going to want to make sure they got the right change. Right. So, again, it's just an easy activity to give them more confidence about how money works.
They do it in school, though, right?
Yeah. I think it's, like, really young.
It is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Refresher course. Okay.
Exactly. Yeah. And they may look at you and say, what are you talking about? Of course I know. But
yeah.
I'm not sure they do.
Certainly some of the people their own age don't. Yeah.
Setting savings goals, and this is, again, and talking about middle school kids in particular, but if your child isn't doing this, or maybe ready younger, have them start to set some goals for that savings money. Because I can say, like I said, my own kids think of it as just more for spending now, you know. So really starting to say, what are you saving that money for? And it can, the younger the kid, the shorter the time frame. I know in eighth grade, here in Bedford, they do the D.C., the Washington, D.C. trip.
Yep.
It's an ideal way to say, okay, you know, this trip is going to cost X. How are you going to save for it? Whether it's for the whole amount or their piece you expect them to pay for. But it's an ideal way to have something that's very real to them and coming up fairly, fairly soon. Okay, so how to keep track of money. And this is, we kind of started to talk about this already, the hard cash versus the online transactions starts to blur that line a bit. So this is where it becomes even more important for them to have their own account, whether it's online or at a bank, and making them keep track of it. I put wallet up here because I don't know about you, but I find crumpled up bills in the laundry. I find them in...
They're mine.
The lunch, well, yeah, they're in the mine, absolutely.
Yeah, that's my way of getting an allowance.
Yeah, they're in the lunch bag. So, you know, I have, and I still find the wallets, you know, on the floor, et cetera. But I think, again, just trying to reinforce, you know, especially with the hard cash, put it in the wallet's yours, you lose the wallet, you're out of luck, right? And then really continually having that conversation. How much do things cost? Moving out of the mode of you doing that in your head, because that's what you're doing, right? When your child wants something, you're thinking, okay, how much does that cost? It's actually having that conversation. How much does it cost? What are my choices for this money? And it takes all of this takes more time, you know, to stop and have these conversations. And I know sometimes that's what we have the least of. Checkbook. So we've talked about savings accounts. At some point here in the middle school, certainly by high school, your child should really have their own checkbook. Now, whether this is a checkbook because they have a checking account at the bank, or it's literally the checkbook for the bank of mom and dad, that's up to you. But understanding, you know, how to keep track of what they spend, how to reconcile. Did anybody here learn how to reconcile a checkbook in high school?
Yeah.
I mean, I did. I'm wondering how many high school kids today know how to do that.
Yeah, if they didn't learn it at home.
Right. Yeah. I mean, where are they going to learn it, and are they going to have to learn it? So you as parents probably need, even if you have to create an artificial environment here a little bit to do it, is start to help them understand. Now, that doesn't mean that they're going to write a lot of checks in their lifetime. I recognize they're probably not. And so this isn't about, I mean, you can teach them how to write a check. It's probably good for them to know. But it's less about that, and it's more about keeping track. Even getting to reconciling. I mean, I use Quicken, and so I download everything automatically. So I literally never reconcile my checkbook anymore. I never have to go through the math. It's done for me on the computer, which is fine. Saves time. But kids need to learn the thought process behind this. So create some kind of checkbook mechanism for them to do this. Okay. So see, I admit the cash is you know on its way out, especially coins. So all right. Okay. Go to the next. Okay, so getting paid what you're worth. So we talked a little bit about allowance, how much to pay. And again, there's no right or wrong answer here. It really gets to how much you want to pay for their things, right? How much do you want them to be responsible for paying? How much do you want to pay? And that's going to be a different number probably in every household. So one of the examples that I was going to read to you, and I forgot to copy it, but is a girl who, and this is great for kids who are really into sports too, because the sports stuff can just get completely out of control. This was a child who was probably, 12, 13, and really loved ice skating. Probably wasn't going to be an Olympian, but really wanted to focus on ice skating and take the classes and do the competitions and, of course, have the outfits, etc. And, you know, this had evolved from taking ice skating lessons once a week to really being something of focus. So the parents in that case decided they were willing to continue to support this passion, but they wanted their child to start keeping track of and understanding the cost associated with it. And so they asked her and made her keep track of the cost, kind of do a little mini budget for it, keep track of the cost. They were still going to pay it. Then they also said, you know, you're going to have to pick up one more chore in the house, you know, and I think they had her cleaning the fridge once a month. Or, I mean, they came up with an appropriate, something that didn't take an inordinate amount of time. But that was, you know, that was her way of earning the money they were going to pay. And that seemed to work in that family. So that's, you know, that's another way of doing it. The other thing that you want to think about around allowance, especially, or where they're spending money, is how much independence are you giving them to make choices? You know, we talked about their consequences, and they need to learn that. One thing we've told our kids is, okay, for those things, and clothing's a good example, for those things that you're going to spend your money on, that's fine, but at the end of the day, we have veto power. So we still keep that veto power. We don't use it very often, but once in a while, something gets picked out, like, not buying that, you know. So we try not to use it very often. Same with toys when kids are younger. You know, you can say, okay, you can buy that. But if it's something that you really, you know, if you don't want you know, an Uzi machine gun toy in your house, I mean, you can say that we're not buying that. So don't give up all responsibility for the choices. We kind of talked about chores again and paying for chores. Jobs, this is the age where they can, but you know, 14, they can start to have part-time jobs. So, you know, if your kids are getting close to that, you want to start thinking about what is my expectation? What do I want them to be thinking about doing? Summer's coming up, but they can do babysitting. They can do special projects around the house. I mean, there are ways they can earn money before they are 14. Same thing with gifts. You know, grandparents give gifts. Gift cards are becoming very popular. How do you want? Think about it ahead of time before it becomes out of control. How do you want your kids handling this? Are you going to let them spend it all at once? Are you going to make them divide it up the same way they have to divide up their allowance? Just be consistent.
Gift cards, yeah.
Yeah, the gift cards make it a little trickier because obviously they can't really divide it up.
We buy them. We give them cash.
Ah, okay.
Unless it's getting
beyond
that thing.
Yeah, so that's, you know, or maybe they, yeah. So, I mean, you just need to figure out how am I going to handle this and be consistent. Okay, so spending wisely. I tried to list all the things that, because I think there was a question, you know, what do you pay for? What do you have your kids pay for? These are ideal places where they can start to pay for some of this. Maybe not 100%, but you can, again, getting to the passions of kids. You know, cell phones. Cell phones are just so good for lots of things.
Yeah.
Discipline. I mean, it's amazing what the power of the cell phone and taking it away.
That's the real power.
Yeah, that is the power. But there's also, it used to be, you know, it had to do with minutes and you could really control that. And nowadays,
usage controls.
Yeah.
I highly recommend usage controls.
So I would say, you know, this is where your child can start to pick up some of the cost. Clothing, clearly, music, anything, you know, if they're the kid that downloads all the stuff all the time, electronics, books, you know, and then the sports we talked about. And there may be other things on this list that are important to your child that you want to, again, Ice Cream Friday. You want to start looking at differently, you know? Yeah. Make sure you're, so we were talking about how to do that, the splitting the cost. I basically kind of put these things, and then I said, okay, parent percentage, kid percentage, and then the last column was the budget. So, you know, this is an easy one. We know how much the cell phone's going to cost for a year. That goes over in the FAR budget, you know, the budget column. And then let's agree, as parents first, and then with the child, how much do you pay for, how much do I pay for? Is it 50-50? Is it 70-30? And do that for each one of these kind of major items. So, and I'll see if Sue has I just don't see the copy of that here. But by doing that, number one, you have a conversation with your children about how much these things cost, but you also start to feel better about how much, you know, they're going to start paying for it. Is anybody doing that already? Something like that?
No.
No?
To lay out the whole thing? No.
Yeah.
But they pay for their texting plan.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, a lot of these things you probably, you know, are doing or thinking or trying, doing some things, but spending the time to actually write it down, have a contract, if you will, with your kids, you know, reinforces kids. Okay, and so, you know, these are all things that we're talking about here, living within a budget. Have them do this lifestyle budget where they, you know, they understand the lifestyle they're planning to lead, how much it costs. Vacation, Christmas. So these are two things that work really well, especially when you're trying to instill this idea of associating cost. Vacation budget. So the next vacation you take, sit down with your children, because you are doing this, I suspect. You are budgeting for your vacation. You know how much it's going to cost. But sit down with them and go through. That way you don't have to divulge all your financial information, right? It's a very contained piece of information. Tell them how much you've been saving per week for this, if that's the case, how much the airfare was, how much the hotel is. And then one thing that we try and do, which, you know, has other benefits, so you don't have three kids fighting the whole time, we also say, okay, here are the activities. We go online, we look at where we're going, here are all the activities. Here is how much the activities cost. Now I've got three kids, you know, here's your activity budget. How are we going to spend this? You know, and some of it has to be done as a family. Some of it can be done separately. But they start to, again, they start to take ownership of this. You know, how much they, first of all, they're going to see how much it really costs to go on vacation, which I think is a huge issue, frankly. Kids, I mean, I had a mom today whose kids are grown say, you know, my kids always thought vacations were free. So, you know, understanding that, but also then having them buy into, well, this is an activity I really want to do, therefore I won't do that. Or, you know, if you have a conversation and no one wants to go horseback riding, why are you signing up for horseback riding? Yeah. So, and you may have to, you know, direct this conversation. You may have to say, this is our budget. This is it. And so they have to make choices. So try that if you haven't done that. Same with Christmas or Hanukkah or anything where there's gift giving involved, lots of gift giving. Again, what's the budget for this? Especially as kids get into middle school and high school, they want to start giving gifts to friends and, you know, family. And I mean, it gets out of, we all know how out of control it can get. Teachers, yeah, the person they met yesterday. I mean, it just doesn't matter. Okay, so those are a couple things you can try. Okay, now we asked about how to invest. And of course, this is a topic that could be covered in a separate 2-hour session. So I, you know, we'll probably skim the surface here. But there are a couple things you really want to make sure your kids understand. Compound interest. Do you think your kids understand compound interest? No? Yeah. You want to talk about this. So I'm going to give you a couple of examples that you can use if you want. Hand those out. So this is partly, this really doesn't tell your kids how to compute compound interest, but I'm sure there are many resources that will walk through the math with them. What this does is show them the power and the beauty of compound interest. So the first example is saying, if you just put in $100 in year one, how much would it grow to be at three different rates? And I use 5%, 8%, which I typically use as an overall average for the stock market. And then I put in 11% for those kids who are willing to take a lot of risk. Yes, or it could be zero. So, you know, just showing them how the money grows is important. And this gets to, you know, being able to delay gratification. I know that's one thing that we said, kids don't want to delay gratification. If you kind of show them if you do, you know, and use whatever interest rate you want to use here. I mean, fortunately, if you use the savings rate at the bank, it's not going to be very much, but... you know, that's, you can use that. I'm sure the bank can even give that to you. The one that I really like, which I use a lot, is to show them the difference between investing early versus late. If they were to put $1,000 a year in at age 15 for 20 years, so they only put in $20,000, by the time they're 65, when they're going to retire, and it grew at 8%, they would have $730,000. That sounds nice. But then when you look and you see, if I wait to start saving till I'm 35, which is frankly when a lot of people start thinking about this, and I save now for 20 years, I'm going to put in $150,000 because I've got to put in $5,000 just to catch up. I'm still not going to have as much. So sometimes those... That example is more powerful around saving for the future than the first one. The other rule of 72 I like to use a lot too is because, especially with kids, you know, how long will it take for my money to double? And if, let's say it grows at 3% a year, which you might be able to get in a CD, maybe, long-term CD, it would take 24 years for your money to double. But if you put it in the market at an average growth rate of 8%, doesn't mean it's going to grow at 8% every year, but average 8%, it would take 9 years for your money to double. Now, the stock market comes with risk. You don't want to put all your eggs in one basket. That's why mutual funds are great. They're diversified. but it's important for kids to start understanding the delayed gratification aspect, the compound interest aspect, the growth that can happen if they put their money away versus spending it now. Because you also want to be teaching them the concept of equity ownership and what it means to own pieces of these companies. I put collections up here because sometimes that's a good way, especially with younger kids, to start getting the idea of something, collecting something of value that will increase in value, whether it's, you know, stamps or trading baseball cards,
musical instruments.
Yeah. Again,
collection, but I'm pretty sure it's worth nothing.
Whatever their passion is, you can link it. Okay. Exercising the entrepreneurial spirit, you know, the old-fashioned lemonade stand, we don't see that anymore, but, you know, I think we sometimes don't encourage, so maybe we do. We don't always encourage our kids to just kind of follow through on some of this and kind of learn how much everything costs to do. And so they may not be a budding entrepreneur, but, you know, maybe they want to raise some money for charity. You know, this is the old Girl Scout model, which, again, we've gotten away from because now the parents take the thing to work. Everybody signs it up. The kids have completely disengaged, I think, from this, what was a great way for them to learn how to raise money. So if you can find ways, or if they come to you and say, I want to do this or I want to do that, really make it, you know, make sure you're, that it's about, you know, a teaching moment for them. Again, how long has Monopoly been around? But it is still one of the best ways to teach kids about money and, you know, accumulating assets and some of the basic things, you know. The only problem is you have to have several hours to play it.
Life doesn't take as long.
Yeah, same, similar, yeah. So, I mean, again, we kind of, you know, these are old, these aren't new ideas, but it's kind of, some of them are still.
Your bake sale will earn you more than a lemonade stand because of the reinforcement for the effort.
So there you go, bake sale. I should have put the bake sale on there. But make sure they are doing the work. They are figuring out the cost, you know, making the connections. Yeah, taking it out of the profits, exactly. Exactly. Okay, how to handle credit. And this is, we were talking about the library earlier. The library card is actually one of the first places that you can reinforce this idea of, I have a card, I get books, if I don't turn the books in, I'm going to pay a fine. You know, you can have a very easy conversation around what, how that relates to a credit card. Now, the problem for me is that I forget to turn the books in on time, and then I end up, so I've stopped going to the library because I've got to control that. My kids, you know, it's under the bed or whatever. So there's it's not always as easy as it sounds. Borrowing from you, the bank of mom and dad. Generally, I sort of discourage this because, you know, kids will want to have advances on their allowance and we tend not to keep track of it or we forgive the loans too easily. But if this is something, especially with older kids, that you can enforce and have some discipline around and charge a little bit of interest just so that they understand the concept, by all means, you know, better to borrow from you and learn, you know, the hard way than to have their first borrowing experience be from a unforgiving bank. Credit cards, debit cards. We talked a little bit about debit cards. I mean, I think especially once they get a checking account, having a debit card, not a bad idea. Credit cards, I might wait till they're in, personally, I might wait till they're in high school to do that before they need to know how to do this before they go to college. And I think a lot
of high school.
It's when they have a job. I would say, I mean, if they have a job and they have income, they can pay a credit card bill, right? May need to be a secured credit card, meaning that they've essentially put money in first. Mm-hmm. So that's a good first step. It may need to be a co-signed credit card.
Scary.
Yeah, which is scary. And this is why a lot of parents don't do this. But then they send their kids off to college with their first credit card ever. And no control, right? So better to practice now on this than send them off where you can't really see what's happening, right? So don't be afraid to do it. Using money to change the world. So, you know, again, we have a lot of charitable giving opportunities. A lot more, I think, than we did when we were growing up, and which is great. But you also, again, want to be making these links. So food drives are a great example. We have food drives. The child says, I got to take some cans in today. They go in the pantry. They grab the cans. They go. Has that taught them anything? No. So the next time there's a food drive, take them to the store, make them pick out the, you know, at least see how much it's costing to provide this. Same with, you know, donations. Just don't you know, you're trying to enforce the idea of being charitable, which is great. But take it a step further and make sure they understand the monetary impact of what you're doing on your money. And sometimes having a family conversation about where are we going to give money this year? Where would you like to give? Where would you like to give? This is a great conversation I have with my kids twice a year with the money they've accumulated in their donate. They each get to pick their own where they want to give it. And we have a conversation about it. So it's a great, you know, it's a great learning opportunity. Okay, so I'm almost done here. So I just to give you the 10 many skills again, so that you can, again, you're not going to be able to, you know, do all of this in one sitting. I would say if there's one here that you really want to spend more time on, focus on that for a while. And once you feel like your child is on the right track, you can move on to one of the, you know, one of the other ones. So it takes time and repeated conversations. So I would just say, ask yourself these three questions. You know, am I modeling the right behavior and attitudes about money with my children? Am I really showing them how I want to be about this? Most of the time. Is my child having to make choices? If they're not making choices about what they want, they're not learning financial responsibility. You have to make it a little bit difficult for them. And then, do I want to be taking care of my children in my retirement? Yeah.
Yeah.
If nothing else motivates you, maybe that will. Right? So, one more cartoon for you.